Hi there, everybody. In this YouTube video, we're going to learn how to optimize profit based on a conjoint analysis. For this tutorial, there's a number of advanced skills that you must already possess to be able to understand our strategy and our outcome. First of all, you must have a basic understanding of what conjoint analysis already is. You've successfully implemented a conjoint analysis and have captured customer-level parameter estimates. Put another way, for those students of mine, you have already ran a conjoint analysis successfully in SPSS and have saved the conjoint output in a SPSS.save file. In addition, there are some skills that if you already possess them, it'll make this tutorial much easier for you to perform. For example, first, you should be familiar and comfortable with relative and absolute cell referencing in Excel. In addition, you should be comfortable with conditional functions in Excel, like if-then statements. If you have some experience with Solver in Excel, specifically Excel 2010 or Excel 2013, you'll be in a really good place to use the analysis tool we're going to do. In addition, we're going to be using the offset function in Excel, and we'll be talking a little bit about array formulas in Excel. Now, for our motivating case, let's imagine that we've conducted a conjoint analysis for a product called Noki. Noki is a product that I found on Kickstarter and I thought was pretty neat, and I imagine that I had conducted a conjoint analysis for this particular product. Now, given we're using fake data here, but in our imaginative scenario, we decided that we were going to study different iterations of the Noki product. First, we considered there were three different levels of hardness for the key: normal hardness, moderate hardness, or ultra hardness. In addition, we imagined there was two different lengths of the throat. That's the little lock, the actual locking mechanism you see at the top there. Either it's a short throat or a long throat, which means you can fit more in it, but it makes the lock a little bigger. Finally, the battery life for this Noki, this wireless Bluetooth powered lock, we imagine came in two different forms. Either you could have a 5-month battery life or an 8-month battery life. In addition, to estimate which version of this Noki product we should bring to market, we had to make some assumptions about our conjoint analysis and how we're going to calculate particular variables. For example, first, we assume that when we conducted this conjoint analysis, we designed it in a way that it identified the maximum price someone was willing to pay for a particular given combination. So in other words, if we showed someone a normal hardness lock with a small throat and a battery life of 8 months, we found out that they would be willing to pay, say, $12.56 for that particular version of the product. Next, we make another assumption. We assume that any time a product is sold at a price anything below what the consumer is willing to pay, they would be willing to buy it because it generates consumer surplus. So in other words, if someone said they'd be willing to pay $12.56 for the product, they will buy it if it costs $12.55. This leaves them a penny off better than they were before. Next, we assume that we could only bring one particular version of this product to the market. So in this case, we imagine there was 12 different types of iterations of the Noki lock that we could bring to market. Right now, we're assuming we have to pick which one of those 12 is the best to bring to market. Of course, in other circumstances, we might imagine we want to bring two different combinations to the market, sort of a light version and a pro version. In addition, we're assuming for now a pretty simple way of calculating our profit, or in other words, gross profit. We're simply going to assume that the price per unit that we're selling a given unit at, minus the cost of manufacturing that unit, multiplied in total by the number of units we sell, equals our profit. Again, that's gross profit. Obviously, fixed costs, the cost of manufacturing varying across the number of units we sold, all of these things could be changed and add some complexity and realism to the situation, but we will be ignoring those for now. What we see here is an SPSS data file that is the file that is created when a conjoint analysis is successfully ran. I've deleted all of the output except for the first portion of output that's relevant here. You'll also have some additional score values over here to the right. These are not relevant for what we're going to be doing. What we see here are the parameter estimates for the different types and iterations of our product for three different people. So we ran this conjoint experiment on only three different individuals: Matt, Allison, and Patty. We have the constant, we have the lock strength at its basic level, hardened level, and ultra level. So since we have three different levels here, the person who's familiar with conjoint analysis will recognize we modeled this as discrete or nominal data. Next, for the throat length, we have a short and long version of the throat. Since we have two different variables here to capture the short and long, again, this is discrete or nominal. Now here we have something a little different, battery life parameter. We only have a single column, but we mentioned that we were studying battery life at both 5 and 8 months. What's going on here? Well, for those of you familiar with conjoint analysis, realize that we must have decided that battery life was going to be considered to have a linear response with people's willingness to pay. So we think that there is a single linear parameter here, for example, Matt, that for every additional month that the battery is able to store energy, he's willing to pay 59 cents an additional for the product. Our first goal is to simply take this information, these parameter estimates for each individual customer, and paste them into an Excel spreadsheet. That's not hard to do. Simply select these variables here, and we can paste them into Excel. Now for our sake, we should add the labels back here and remind ourselves of what's going on. Now I've created a cleaned up version of this output. I'm going to click onto that tab to show you what it looks like. I want to reiterate to you that these are still the exact same numbers. I've just written descriptions reminding myself of what each one of these parameters correspond with. And then since I remember I basically can write a regression formula, if you will, for every individual customer, I reminded myself to give these parameters sort of the traditional regression letter names, like beta 0, the constant, up to beta 6. And I then wanted to remind myself, and again, this is something you don't have to do, but I wanted to remind myself how this information corresponds into an individual calculation for a person. So the general form is here. The lock price that a given customer is willing to spend, the price a given customer is willing to pay for the lock price, is a function of their constant, the price they're willing to pay for the basic, hard, or ultra version, the price they're willing to pay for the short or long version, and the battery life they're willing to pay. Now, if I take the parameters for, let's say, Matt, I can generate a particular iteration here. So the lock price for Matt is $6.77, that's his constant, minus $1 times 1. So apparently in this case, I'm considering, since it's a dummy code, I'm talking about the basic version of the lock. And of course, that means the hardened lock is multiplied by 0 because I'm only talking about the basic. So it should be a 1, a 0, and a 0 here. Then for the throat length, I'm considering, in this particular example of the equation, I must be talking about the short throat length, because again, I have a 1 here for the short length. And since I'm talking about the short length, I can't be talking about the long length. So we have a 0 here. And then for battery life, instead of 0, we should type in the number 5. Because we're studying both 5 and 8 months, I'm going to assume that we're talking about a 5-month-long battery for Matt here. And if we solve this equation out, simply do the arithmetic, we'll find that the lock price for Matt we would estimate to be $8.56. Matt would be willing to pay up to $8.56 for a basic strength lock with a short throat and a 5-month battery. And we could do this for every iteration. Now this is long and tedious, so what we need to do is figure out how to set up this form where this is calculated for every different iteration of the product for every individual customer. Let's set that up. Our first step here is we want to generate all the different combinations of X input variables that will iterate across all different 12 types of product combinations that we can have for this particular conjoint. So I created some workspace over here on the right hand side. Obviously I colored these in a little bit ahead of time. But what we'll do here is we're going to create a matrix, and along the columns we'll have the 12 different product combinations. Since we have a 3 by 2 by 2 experiment, we have 12 possible combinations, and in this column here we will reference each different individual attribute. So here, I'll simply type product combo number to tell myself what the combination is. And this is product 1 will go here, product combination 2 will go here, product combination 3 will go here. And we simply drag this all the way over up to 12, telling us that yes, we need to create 12 different product combinations. Next, we want to make sure we have one row for each one of our parameters in our model, not including the constant. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 variables here. Parameters. We will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We can simply call these the attribute numbers. And we do want to call these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 specifically. We'll use these numeric values in a moment. Next, in this space here, we want to take lock strength, basic, and place that text here, lock strength, hardened and place that below, and so on and so forth. Now, we could just copy and paste or just type this manually, but let's do a little bit better. All we really need to do here, create a function in this cell that references lock strength here and then pulls down in order. A good way to do this is the offset function. So to create an offset function, I'm in this cell now, J12. I'm going to say equals offset. It says it returns a reference to a range that is a given number of rows or columns from a given reference. Okay. So first we set up our initial reference. Our initial reference here will be this point, C19. This is our basic reference. And then from this reference, this reference is being the coordinates of 0, 0. It's our reference point, 0, 0. We don't want it to move any number of rows, so it'll go 0. And then we do want it to move one column minus 1. We have minus 1 here because we want it to stay on 0, 0. Now, before we go ahead and drag this function down here, and notice we get a bunch of values that we did not want to have referenced, we need to make sure that we keep our reference here, this offset, this initial cell reference of C19 fixed. So we can either manually type in front of C the money sign, in front of the 19 the money sign, to do a fixed reference here. Or for those of you who have Windows computers, you can simply hit F4, and F4 toggles through the different relative and absolute reference options right there. But now when we drag our function all the way down, we'll see that now, as each it moves through, now it's referencing 1 over, now it's referencing 3 minus 1 over, so 2, so it's grabbing lock strength here and placing it up in this value. This is really nice. This offset tool is very useful for returning values from a given fixed position somewhere else in your spreadsheet. Okay, so we've generated our product combination iterations. We've set the attributes, and we use those numeric values to create an offset that allowed us to automatically generate this. The next thing that we have to do, though, is we have to create each possible combination iteration for this product. So, for example, we do know one possibility is that someone is interested in the basic lock, which is dummy coded as a 1, and if they're interested in the basic lock, we're not talking about the hardened and ultra hardened lock, so therefore be a 1-0-0 combination. And for attribute for product 2, I know for a fact that someone says basic, it'd be 0, but if they're interested in hardened, be 1, ultra hardened, and then similarly 0-0-1 down here. So this first part here that I just set up, this little 3x3 matrix, that sets up all the possible combinations for the lock strength. In this case, I have to create all 12 feasible combinations, but I know that this combination set will repeat itself 3 more times. So I simply copy and paste this iteration over. For the short throat, I know that there is a 1 and 0 combination here. And now this second product combination right here, number 2, has a 0, 1, 0, so that's a new combination. So I put a 1 and 0 here again. And now this is ultra strength, so this is 1 and 0. So that's one combination set. Now, for the lock strength basic, I have a combination of 1, hardened 0, 0. And I don't want to type when 1 here because we already have it taken care of over here in the first product combination. So we go 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. Cool. So now we set this up, and now we know that this will simply copy over into our next set. And then finally, for battery life in months, we decided that we are studying two particular iterations of battery life, either a 5-month-long battery or an 8-month-long battery. So for these first 6 products, I will choose these to be our 5-month-long batteries, and here's where we type in our 8-month-long batteries. Now, why did I type in 5 and 8 here directly instead of these dummy code systems I've been using before? Well, that's because, remember, our battery life variable we scored as a linear, or we set up as a linear predictor in our conjoint experiment.
So we only have a single parameter, and typically when you're coding those values initially, you'll actually code them in the original raw metric that is relevant. In this case, number 5 literally corresponds to 5 months, where in the earlier cases for dummy codes, it merely indicates a 1 indicates present, while 0 means not present. We really haven't done anything yet. We simply set up the initial portion of the problem. We still have an additional setup step that we need to do. We need to include our costs, our pricing, and our profit estimates into this model as well. We'll do that next. Okay, at this stage, we still have our original conjoint output parameter estimate data for our 3 particular individuals. We've now successfully created all of the different iterations of product combinations for our 12 different product combinations. We use the offset function to bring our labels back over. In this step, we still have one more setup thing we need to do. We need to bring pricing information, cost per unit information, and profit per unit information. That's easy enough for us to do. We can put in price here, we can put in cost per unit here, and we'll call it profit per unit here. We'll slap you with our terminology. Now, for price is going to be the input into our model. We want to figure out what price ought to be. Starting at some arbitrary default point, let's imagine we're going to charge $1 for every one of these 12 different types of products. This is just a temporary placeholder. These prices are definitely going to change pretty soon. And since we know this is going to be an input into our model, that we're going to be changing these prices, let's go ahead and color that something that's distinguishable and easy for us to see, like bright green. Now, cost per unit for each one of these products. So when we sell product combination 1, we should type in what it's going to cost to sell that unit. So what's the cost for the materials and whatever sort of per unit marketing cost we might attribute to this, packaging, so on. For now, we're going to assume that the cost per unit for each one of our 12 products is exactly the same. So this is kind of an interesting assumption, because we're saying that the hardened and ultra hardened versions of the pieces of equipment are exactly the same. The Nokia's 5-month battery and 8-month battery are exactly the same. These are clearly poor assumptions. It's probably going to cost us more money to manufacture the 8-month-long battery version. But again, for now, let's just create a space where we hold these pricing variables. We're not so much worried about having these right. After all, I'm not the person who actually has to worry about manufacturing the Nokia. But let's just keep in mind that we will have these created here and that we can utilize them and adjust them later. Finally, our profit per unit. We'll do this really easily. We'll simply go the price of the product minus the cost of the product. In this case, for each unit we sell, we'd be losing $4. I'm going to clear this out, though. Let's add in one little wrinkle to this. Now, when we look at this price, right now we have them set at $1 each. Now, we know we're going to change it from $1, but as we're thinking ahead to actually bringing this Nokia product to market, one of the things that we may realize is that we want to behave somewhat traditional in our pricing approach. We want to make sure that our pricing always ends in 99 cents. I'm sure you've seen that all around U.S. stores where products are priced at $17.99, not $18 round. So let's add in what we'll call this the 99 cent convention. And this is simply going to be $1, referencing the cell above, plus, and then literally just type in 99 cents. And this is a calculated set of cells here that's just referencing these above. So for example, if I change this to 2. So really, this is our input, the original dollar value. But let's just assume that we ultimately will be charging, even though if we want to charge $2, we'll ultimately choose to charge $2.99. This will be what we bring to market. So we'll account for this 99 cent convention. So when we calculate profit per unit, it'll actually be $1.99 using the 99 cent convention minus the cost per unit. Now we drag this all the way across. Okay. And clearly, as it stands right now, we'd be losing money for every single unit of every type of product combination that we sell. But we have successfully set this part of the model up. Our next step, we're really going to start building this model out in a way that's meaningful. We're going to figure out how much someone is willing to pay and how much they're and what they value each type of these iterations of the products. In this part of the exercise, we want to calculate the consumer surplus that each customer would have if they purchase our product at the price that we're proposing. And remember, consumer surplus is simply the amount of money that a customer would have been willing to pay in addition to what they actually paid for the product. So to start that off, we're going to create a new matrix right in here that for each of our three customers shows the consumer surplus that'd be left over if they bought each one of these versions of the products, these 12 versions of the product. So simply let's set this up. Let's hit the equal sign here and reference our original people's names here so we don't have to retype them. So we have our three individuals. And above here, let's go ahead and just type consumer surplus. Now, let's focus in here on this person, Matt. I'm in cell K20. And now for Matt, we know his valuations of the different characteristics of the product. And for this particular product, looking at it, we can say that we're talking about the basic lock strength with a short throat length and 5 months of battery life. What we want to do here is every time we see a one here, we want to multiply that out by the value for the basic lock strength. And every time we see a zero here, we want to multiply it up by zero. So we're simply executing that equation that y equals parameters times level of each variable that we had established earlier at the very beginning of this exercise. Now the way to do this is we can do this in one fell swoop. We're going to use a neat function here in Excel called equals mmult, M-U-L-T. It stands for matrix multiplication. So it's going to return the matrix product of two different arrays, same number of rows as way to run, and columns as array two. So here's how it works. So I equals mmult, parenthesis, and our first array, and be careful where I'm selecting here. I'm selecting from starting at lock strength. Notice I'm ignoring the constant, and I select this array, comma. Now I select my second array, and that is here. And that'll simply multiply out each combination of these six characteristics by the six different levels. Then we have to add in our constant. And then finally, we have to subtract out the cost. So we'll subtract out by K4, the 199 convention. And now, because we used an array formula, mmult is a special type of formula. It's an array formula. And by rule, when you're dealing with array formulas in Excel, you have to alert Excel that you're dealing with array formulas. And the way to do that is if we simply executed this equation as is, it will not work correctly. We must hit Control, Shift, then Enter. So hit and hold Control. While holding Control, hit and hold Shift. And while hitting and holding Control and Shift, hit Enter. And it returns the correct calculation. Now let's see what happened here when we did this. If you look up here in mmult, notice that there's these squiggly brackets surrounding the entire formula, even starting before the equal sign. This is its way of indicating to Excel that yes, we are indeed dealing with an array formula, which has mmult inside of it. So that's an array formula, the part of the array formula that it has to be coped with. Okay. Now, we certainly set up this equation for Matt for this individual product, but ideally, we should be able to simply click and drag this formula so that it works for every single customer, for every single product. And that doesn't work if we do it by just default. What we need to do here is we need to correctly set all the immediate cell references. So for example, we're going to do this very carefully. Let's first start with our first array in mmult, and we realize that we need to put the dollar sign in front of the C in the H. In other words, even if I drag this equation to the right, make sure it holds true and locks across cells C to H. But it's okay that if I drag this down, it'll move the bars down to Allison and Patty. Now for K-12 through K-17, we have to flip it up. I want to make sure that we're always dealing within the 12 to 17 row range. So we need to lock out the 12 and the 17, but the actual column letters, in this case K, should be allowed to vary freely. So if I drag it to the right, I do in fact want this to start grabbing the L values. Now for the constant here, we again lock that out at the B, but 20 is allowed to vary freely. And finally for the K4, which is the product price, the $1.99 convention, we only want to lock out the 4. And again, now we've gone in and we've messed around with the matrix multiplication formula. So when we exit out of it, it's good practice again to hit Control, Shift, Enter. By doing this, we'll have correctly set up all of our different consumer surplus formulas. Now to verify this worked correctly, we should check Patty's final product combination. So if we investigate this particular setup, we should hope to see that our multiplication is referencing, let's see, our price up here, yes. It representing this set of combinations for the product, which is good. There's the constant, and there's the row. So very good, we set up our cell references correctly. And I get Control Shift Enter to get out of this again. So now interpreting these, what we're saying here is for Matt, looking at this cell, if we were to sell to Matt this product for $1.99, left over in value would be $6.57 from Matt's perspective. He'd have been willing to pay that much additional more. Put another way, anytime we see a positive value down here, we would assume that a customer is willing to purchase the product. Anytime we see a negative value, the person wouldn't be willing to purchase the product at that price. To see how this works, let's go ahead and change the price of this first product from $1 to $5. And even if we increase the price all the way to $5, meaning we're going to charge $5.99, all three individuals would still be willing to buy the product. However, if we raise it to $6, people are still willing to buy it. $7, still willing to buy it. But at $7.50, which means the 99-cent convention would be $8.49. That's a little strange, but that's okay. Just for the illustration here, Matt would still willing to buy the product because it's 7 cents left over or surplus, but Allison and Patty would not bother to purchase the product. All right, and I'll switch this back to an integer value of 6. So we've now established, using this matrix here, we've been able to take the individual parameter estimates of each customer for each product combination, and based on a given price level for each level for each product, we've determined whether or not someone would be willing to buy. We're going to use this information one step further to figure out which is the correct setting, a correct product to offer to maximize profitability. Okay, this next step is relatively easy. We simply want to take this consumer surplus information and codify it into a much more simple rule. That is, would the person buy the product or would they not buy the product at that given price point? So we're gonna create another matrix just below. Let's call it the would buy matrix. Again, let's reference our three individuals. So Matt, I did a cell referencing of Matt and Allison and Patty, so I don't have to type it manually. And here, we're simply going to use a simple if-then logic statement within Excel. So right now I'm in cell K25. And I'll hit equal if, and I'm looking at Matt's first product combination here. If this product, so in this case it's $1.57, if this is greater than zero, which means it has positive consumer surplus, meaning Matt would buy the product, we'll hit comma. The value of true it'll return is a 1, meaning 1 will signify yes, Matt would buy the product at that price. And then if it's false, if it's not greater than 0, it'll return a, will return a 0 false. And that was relatively easy. Now some of you clever Excel users may realize, hey, I could easily merge the consumer surplus and the would buy into one single function inside a single cell. You're absolutely right, you could. For this exercise, I think it's useful for us to keep them separate. All right, we're almost near the end. We just have to then calculate the estimated profit for each product combination. And then based on that, we will use an evolutionary solver algorithm to determine the optimal price. Okay, we have established whether or not a customer buy a product. Now let's use that information to help us figure out what the estimated profit would be for a given product being sold. So right below here, let's call this product profit. And it's a pretty simple equation. We simply just say equals the sum of the would buy columns here. So for the first product, all three people would buy. So if we sum this up, it'd be 3, indicating 3 people would be willing to buy. At this point, you'd realize that maybe we would want to add some sort of multiplier effect. Obviously, there's hopefully more than 3 people on our market. So each one of these individuals might be multiplied by some value to represent the total size of the market, for example. So we simply sum this out, and then we multiply this by the profit per unit up top. Hit return. Okay, so if we sold this product to these three individuals, all three would buy, leaving us with $5.97 if we had sold the product at $6.99. Select this all the way across. And right now we see a bunch of negative values for all the other cells because we set the price of $6 to this first one, and the other ones we had left at either $1 or $2 in some instances. No surprise there that when we sell a product for $1 or $2 that costs $5 to make, we're not making any money. But we sure are selling products. Let's create one more final cell here, just to the right of all the product profits. Let's hit a cell, let's call this function that finds the maximum profit of all these 12 iterations. So this will just equal max, selecting these 12 cells that we just generated. I'm going to draw a little arrow next to this to say max profit. And I'm going to color this red. So it's saying that, look, out of all these different combinations, the most money we can make is $5.97. And then we would find $5.97 here, realizing that we should sell product one for $6. All right, we set everything up. At this point, now we're going to let solver do the hard work for us. For this final portion of the exercise, we're going to use a really powerful tool that's available within Excel called Solver. Solver is a tool that helps us optimize an output given a series of inputs and an underlying model that we have built. To find Solver, simply go to your Data tab. And under there's an analysis menu here, and you should see solver right here. Not solve, solver. If you don't see solver, that means you haven't installed it on your Excel 2010 or Excel 2013 machine yet. This is easy to do. It's a free piece of software that's already preloaded. You just have to activate it in Excel. Simply Google how to install solver in Excel 2010 or 2013 for your PC or your Mac, and you'll find out how easy it is to do this. For the rest of you who've already done this, let's go ahead and click on Solver. When we look at the Solver menu, we have an objective. In this case, our goal is to maximize profit. So let's go ahead and reference our max profit cell right here. The biggest number possible that we can reach here is what we want. So we want to maximize this value, and then so right here it's already set to 2 maximize. It's also possible to minimize that value or reach a particular value, but in our case we want to maximize profits. Now by changing individual cells, in this case, we want to change our pricing cells. So we want to change these different prices. So we're going to manipulate those by to reach the maximum profit possible. Now, when we select our solving method, that's about near the bottom here, there's three different options. Make sure you have evolutionary solver set. Now, there's something important to keep in mind when using evolutionary solver. Evolutionary solver is an iterative procedure, meaning it tries a bunch of different combinations following a somewhat intelligent methodology to reach hopefully close to the optimum value. However, there's no guarantee that it will reach the absolute best value possible. In other words, we might find what seems to be the max profit, but really there's a better solution out there. Another possibility is that when you run your solver algorithm, you might get a slightly different result than what I get when I show that here. Don't freak out. That happens. It's called a local optima issue, and we're not going to talk about it too much in detail here, but other than that, then know that it can occur. Now, to make solver work a little more intelligently, there's one more thing we need to do. When we use an evolutionary solver, it's really important that we tell solver what the lower and upper boundary is for each one of our input variables. So for each one of these pricing variables in green that we have over here, we want to set a lowest and maximum value for it to work from. We've already actually set the lowest possible value. Do you see here where we checked the default box was checked that said make unconstrained variables non-negative? This is simply saying by default, all of these input values for price are going to be some sort of non-negative value. They'll be greater than zero. And of course that makes sense because we can't have a negative price. It's also important that we set a maximum price. In this case, I'm going to hit the add button here where it says subject to the constraints. And I'm going to reference all of these cells simultaneously. All of these cells, for each one of these cells individually, I'm going to set a little bit arbitrarily that I'm not going to even entertain charging more than $40 for any one of these combinations of products, so less than or equal to 40. Rule of thumb, set some sort of number that is above what you think is really pragmatic or feasible. And then let the evolutionary solver work from there. In this case, I already know ahead of time that anything above 40 is just simply not going to work. So I'm going to hit add. That adds it into the system. And there's one more thing we're going to do. Remember earlier how we wanted to assure that when we charged our prices for these products, we charged exactly, say, $3.99, $12.99, or $18.99. We always wanted it to end in 99. Well, we're going to take advantage of this trick in solver. We're going to, again, select all of our input cells. And here, instead of a less than or equals to sign, we're going to select this and we're going to switch to INT. All this is doing is setting a constraint to integer. In other words, we can't have fractional values for the price input. So all these values can either be, say, $1, $2, $3, $4, $5, and $6, but it can't be $4.76. Since we manually add on 99 cents later, we can assure that we will always have prices that are exactly ending in 99. Once we've added that in, we can simply cancel out of this menu. We know that we've added this in correctly because we should be able to see our subject to our constraints here. And again, I want to emphasize when we start solving this, it's entirely possible you might see slightly different results than me. While this is running, look in the bottom left-hand corner of your Excel sheet while it's running. You should be able to see the different iterations happening in real quick. So I'm going to hit the solve button and go. And I'm now watching the bottom left-hand corner of my Excel sheet solve. And automatically I can see that it was able to find a solution where I was able to make $13.98, which is clearly an improvement from my $5.97. In the meantime, solver continues to iterate across other possible sub-solutions, trying to find something that's better than $13.98. It's still going. When solver stops, it should reach a final menu. And notice the output it tells you. Notice here it says, solver cannot improve the current solution. All constraints are satisfied. This is a really funny way for it to say, yes, I found an answer, but I'm not sure if it is the absolute best answer. It just said it can't improve the current situation. It didn't commit to saying it found the best solution to the situation. So we can go ahead and keep the solver solution and click OK here. What we should see here in the inputs are all the different, some of the different prices that solver settled on as it was iterating across different pricing options. What's important to us is where we maximized our profit of $13.98. And if we look over to our left, we can see which product that corresponded to. That was our very last product here at $11, which means actually at $11.99. At $5 of cost, making a profit of $6.99 per unit sold. The most appealing product for us to sell to our customers was the ultra hardened lock with the long throat and 8 months battery life. When we sell this product, Matt and Allison are left a little better off, so they're willing to buy the product. However, for Patty, Patty's not willing to buy this product. So even though we didn't sell to all three customers, we sold at a price that made it rather profitable for us to sell it to those two customers. Pretty cool. So while this example only worked for three customers, you can easily imagine how we could scale this up to a survey of, say, 100, 200, or 300 customers. I've now shown you figure out a way to optimize profitability for a new product based on a conjoint analysis, some basic cost assumptions or cost inputs that you have, and using some very powerful tools that are available inside Excel. This is you moving along your steps to become a high-powered Excel user.